And those are some residents of Accra here who have had, who were observing people who have had their homes flooded. And these people are removing luggage, their property, their very lives from their homes. So I'm here in the studio with Raymond Akwa, Northern Akwa, Hereford and Enimo Enimado. Raymond will take us through a bit of what we have seen in the past, some of the solutions that have been suggested, why some of the solutions have not worked. Northern has some very, I've been reading your article, Northern, some very interesting ideas about how we must prepare for these disasters in the first place. But anymore, flooding again?
So yesterday when it started to rain, I was actually a bit happy because it's been hot for the past few days. So my initial emotion was really just excitement. But I was driving home and then a friend of mine texted me and she was like, Nims, whatever you do, don't go through Circle because it's flooded. I'm sitting in a, she drives a Kia Picanto and she was sitting in traffic at Circle. And so I called her. And without over sensationalizing what happened, you know, she did sound a little bit panicky because, and I understood her anxiety because she was in traffic at Circle. It was flooded. Her car was spoiled. And we all know what happened at Circle a few years ago. And so suddenly my excitement turned to staying on the phone with my friend until she was able to move from there. I find it very sad that we can't really look for it to rain or you can't even enjoy it because you're thinking about the people who may be stuck in the rain. You're thinking about sellers. You're thinking about traders. The fact that people's wares are going to get spoiled, that gutters are going to get choked, that houses are going to get flooded, and that people may lose their lives. We're almost in June. I remember from last year, we have kept on saying and sending out this reminder to government that June will come again, that the rainy season will come again. Apart from the occasional you see them removing rubbish and stuff from the gutters, apart from that occasional removal, I don't really know what has been done dramatically to prepare us for the rains which have started coming.
So Raymond will tell us some of those actions, but you know, it's really ironic that this comes the Monday after we've seen a back and forth and a back again about how, who has managed the economy better. Isn't it, you know, doesn't
ironic.
That put it in?
Yeah, yet? It kind of mm-hmm. does, doesn't it? Mm-hmm. Raymond, sorry, what were you going to say?
Okay, so you do recall that just last year, and Dr. Aya Hefron was last year, right?
Yes.
Dr. And I don't want to, I don't want to remind the families of their pain. But me, I said here that this state doesn't learn anything. They will not do anything. They will not care that we lost a medical doctor, somebody ordinarily whose responsibility would have been to take care of almost 40,000 or so people a day in this country. We lost that particular person because we have failed to fix a single problem on our hands for a very long time. You do recall that in 2012, 2013, the then, no, 2011, more importantly, the then president, the late J.E. Mills, had gone out there to speak that we are engaging an American company to start the Conti project. The Conti project had two major phases. Immediately, clear drains, do dredging, make sure that you can now and reconstruct some of them. Again, it also required six different levels of reconstruction of drains, including storm drains. Yesterday, what came to mind when I was actually using the Atimota overhead, the one close to the new station, Atimota new station, was that when I looked at, I saw that drain. The drain is big, but it was almost full. Our idea was that we're going to do bigger ones, once underground, ones that can take all the water coming down, because we knew as far back as 1925 that Accra is in a very low-lying area. So in 1925, we planned to make sure that we'll fix that problem. Even Gugisberg planned to fix the same problem. In Nkrumah's time, we had a plan to fix the same problem. Again, fast forward, I don't want to do a list of floods that happened within a period and the people that have died. I just went to last year. I don't want to go to the fire flood disaster
of 2015
that almost cleared almost 200 people from this country. Just last year, again, I spoke with Deputy Minister in charge of housing. The gentleman was very clear in his mind that their budget was limited, But by the end of the year, they've gotten the money to do all the needed dredging and the building of drains. So when I saw that they were working on that Malam drain, which affected the road,
yes,
because in that 2015 fire flood disaster, 9 people died at that spot, Malam drain. 9 people died there.
Mm.
So I was excited that something was being done about it. But when we said we were going to Conti and we had arranged for 600 million, we knew that the problem was comprehensive and required that we fix all of them together, that not transport the problem from one end to the other.
Exactly.
So you might have tried building the Malam drain, but the water moves to another level. That drain is in that clog, too small, can't take it up, so it ends up in people's houses. Can you get the fact that,
but you see, Raymond,
when our first reaction,
let's also admit that like I said, I've said repeatedly, driving to work this morning, I saw so much garbage that has been brought out by the water onto the streets. So we also can't lose sight of the fact that beyond the construction, there is also the repeated maintenance and the repeated sanitation of our roads.
But you see, forgive me,
our environment.
It's because we know people will be irresponsible. Because we know not all Ghanaians are right-thinking people. That's why we have laws and people to implement them. That's why every single small assembly has a sanitation officer whose responsibility is to make sure that with the team, they work at it. Because we know that even when people have gotten education, they can still depart from what is expected of them. That is why we have people whose responsibility will be to collect the garbage. Now, we cannot forget the fact that you have put your resource in people's hands to authoritatively allocate it to the areas that we don't recur, and we don't have this thing recurring consistently. What we've not been able to do, and nobody can convince me otherwise, is that we are not committed to fixing the problem.
Okay.
Because if you know you have this problem and you know you've been trying to work at it consistently, show me from last year to this year. And this is a man that was talking to the minister. He said, oh, we are mindful of it. We will do the dredging more. But the construction will start immediately.
Okay, I'll stop you there because the main point, Norvin, that the deputy minister told Raymond was that it's a matter of money.
Yep.
Which is where you come in.
Yes. And interestingly, when the Raymond said that, and then I just remembered even my conversation with the NATMO guys trying to understand, you know, if we have the finance, do we have the money to be able to do this? Let me share some few statistics with you. Now, between 1998 and 2017 alone, according to the UN International Strategy for Disaster Reduction, the economic losses that we've had in Africa alone due to disasters is $2.9 trillion, of which climate-related disasters accounted for $2.2 trillion. And this is very, very interesting. And if you look at 2014 alone, if you look at the economic and social burden of natural disaster and disease outbreaks on the continent, it's pegged at $53.19 billion. So it tells you that when disaster hits you, you might want to think that, oh, it's okay. You would try and manage the situation. You get rice and whatever to distribute, try and then move people from where they find themselves, see what you can do. But the economic loss to you as a nation is very critical. And I ask the question that in the 2020 budget, should the Minister of Finance, Ken Ofori-Atta, you know, consider ensuring that we can have some funds allocated which we could use to deal with it? And when you even allocate the funds, what are you going to do with it? Is this just going to be sitting there hoping that when a disaster hits us, then those monies will be used or what? Then I remember that in 2012, African leaders, when they met at the AU, they decided to form what they call the African Risk Capacity Agency, because then they believe that, listen, disaster is with us.
Mm-hmm.
Climate change is with us. Mm-hmm. And you talk of outbreaks, epidemics, you talk of river flooding, mm-hmm. As what we see in Accra every now and then. You talk of droughts that hits us because the climate is changing and you're not having the rainfall patterns as it should be all the time. So it meant that how do we prepare and ensure that we don't have droughts that would lead into farming? So what do we do? And so when they form this, then the insurance agency was formed. And then they said, look, you know what? every country, let's look at what you have. They first of all try to build a software which you could use in reading the various countries, which will predict disasters ahead of time, be it drought, be it river flooding, be it whatever that gives
be
you...
Be it what's happened last night?
Yes, so they give you a warning ahead of time.
For the entire continent?
For the entire continent. So when the system reads, so you feed your meteorological agency even to it. And Ghana in 2016, I think February or so, signed on to the treaty. Mm-hmm. And also just this February this year, we signed on to engage the insurance pool of the African risk capacity to ensure that, okay, what can we do? But the question is, we know that African countries and Ghana have issues. The money to get and say, okay, you're going to put this money aside. And it's done country by country basis.
Which is where the challenge is, because Ghana could be paying, and all these other countries, if they don't, we would be in trouble if it's time for us to access the funds.
Well, what they have done, and which is interesting, is that if you don't sign on, you don't get anything. So let me give you the situation.
But the question is, you can sign on and not pay. So that will the fund itself have money? For instance, if last night we had needed money after last night and we didn't have majority of the countries signing on and paying, will there still be money available to us?
Well, if you sign on and you don't pay, you don't get anything.
You don't get what I'm saying. Insurance is investment.
Yes, of course.
Basically. So we need all the money from all of us in this room to come together for us to go and invest before your premium can pay you back.
Can pay you back, exactly.
Exactly. So if you have paid, the few of us have not paid, and you need money for your risk, what happens to you?
Well, I think that it is my money that has been invested. So whatever it is, something will come to me. But then the two of them, which is Raymond and Enimo, who have not paid, when
they
there's a problem,
access
they
it.
Cannot access any premium. And that's the
is
situation.
There any seed funding for the...
There was a seed funding. I think $200 million was used.
Okay,
in,
so there's
in,
some money there.
That was used in establishing that. But the question that coming back home, many years, as Raymond said, we've seen flooding in Accra, we've seen all the things that happened to us. And of course, even the rainfall patterns within the northern part of the country, when the first assessment was done, we've seen that that has also changed. So how do we ensure that even the food basket of our country is also saved? And I in my discussions with the team that is working from the Ghana side, they have told us that, okay, the first thing they want to look at is to deal with the agriculture side. They are also bringing in the river flooding issues. But the key question is the money that we need to be able to do this.
So we've had projects on our books that we should implement that we haven't dedicated the money to implement, from what Raymond has told us, from what Norvan has made us understand. There's even disaster relief available to us if we make contributions to the ARCA.
Yes.
And we haven't made those contributions there. Any more priorities?
Yes, it would seem as if we're not prioritizing this issue. The thing about Ghana that I have noticed, and forgive me if this is an uninformed observation, but when we're looking for money to do something, especially when it will help us win an election, we find the money somehow, don't we? Free SHS is important. I agree with, you know, the fact that our children need to go to school, but we found the money to do that, didn't we? We're fulfilling our campaign promises, and yet year on, government changing. I don't think that maybe the government thinks it's something that's really important to us, or maybe can win an election, which is why then they haven't done anything about
maybe
it. So maybe we need to.
Maybe the people have not made them know that this is what we need.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say next. That maybe it's up to us now to let them know that if they don't fix it, then they will lose our trust, which is really belittling the issue. But it's also a two-sided thing. And I'm going to messages now because I really want to reflect what people are thinking when it comes to this drainage issue. So there's one here. Yeah, this one got me. This one says, just 45 minutes of rain and our $200 million circle Dubai. And remember how quickly that project was finished leading up to the last elections.
Exactly.
So yes, our $200 million circle Dubai and some major roads in Accra all flooded. So what is it about our engineers that they can't find solution to our problems? Are we as a nation wasting our resources training engineers, or is it our technocrats and politicians who are wasting our resources pretending to be building as good roads and drainage. Mr. President, our engineers need some firing. That's an opinion, and well, it's targeted at engineers. This one says, with this sanitation menace in Ghana, I suggest we should make the military men sanitation officers. The government should dredge the various storm drains and leave the rest to the military. They should be on duty both day and night, and we will see immediate change. If, for instance, rubbish is found in a particular area, all the people living there should be rounded up and charged with the offense. That way, we'll make every citizen an environmental vigilante. This madness in Ghana must stop. Rains are supposed to be blessings. That's from Vera Ofosu. MFA just simply says, we Ghanaian urban dwellers are just dirty. This one says, why would Ghana not cover its drains? The open drains that the road constructor does is a disaster that started at the construction point. Death of innocent citizens, floods affecting people who may not contribute to dirt and gutters. Meanwhile, they're having floods in their homes, etc. And the original cause is the open gutters and citizens' behavior. So there seems to be, you know, a sort of citizens' behavior, and also the fact that our drainage systems are just not...
Which is also a leadership action.
Yeah, yeah.
So here's the thing. Whether it's citizens or it's leadership, people need to act. And I feel that if we have responsible citizens, we can hold our leaders more accountable. And we can put our leaders to task. Because look, we have seen time and time and again that the Ghanaian politician understands the election. And the Ghanaian politician understands that's the gun that you can hold to his head. How many town hall meetings have we had where people queue and ask about sanitation? People queue and ask about flooding? Unless something happens and someone dies.
Yeah.
You know, what concern have we shown as a people? Look at what happened with the Madina Adenta Highway, where people started on social media, where people went on a random demonstration. Look at what happened with the road toll levy. People demanded. The people in this country who we know that when we speak people here, when they speak people here, they demanded on social media. It started a whole mass movement. You get what I'm saying? So sometimes maybe we also need to turn the guns on ourselves as citizens and ask ourselves, can we just complain or we can do a bit more about it? I just received some pictures here of a tree that has broken down onto a red Nissan vehicle. It's a Nissan vehicle. It looks like a sedan. Okay, it's a red Nissan. I'm told it's a Bishop Bowers at Latebiokoshi. And the vehicle, the tree has been totally uprooted. This could not have happened overnight unless, of course, the rain was involved. But it's totally been ripped out of the ground. So you can see the roots sticking up and pointing in the air. It's a huge tree, enough to actually break the entire top of this vehicle. And so there's nothing like glass. There's nothing like a roof. It's quite disturbing. We'll call upon the authorities, particularly NADMO, to come to the aid of these persons. Just like this person has sent the pictures, you can also send in... if you need some assistance directed to you, you can send in your message on 0244-340-437. Malik, you want to tell us more about that?
Yeah, I just said that the roads have actually been blocked in this area. So what NADMO needs to do is go there with chainsaws and cut the tree so that the roads
will
be cleared.
So the tree has broken onto the road.
Yeah, there are two trees actually.
Two trees?
Yes. This information we are getting from persons who live around this area.
Was a car parked?
Luckily, there was nobody in the car when the tree fell on it.
Yeah. Okay, thank you very much.
And one more minute. When Raymond was talking about the doctor who died last year, that particular area is being built. Meanwhile, this is an area where large volumes of water pass through. They are building on that land, which was wasteland that water would pass through normally. This exact location where the doctor died is being built.
Remember,
and nobody is saying anything. NADMO is watching. Everybody, the authorities are watching. Wait and see when the rains come this year, what will happen in that part of the road.
Remember, that's when we hosted Engineer Wise Ametewe. That's the name, right? Yes, of the Ghana Hydrological Survey. And he told us that there's one stream that has split into two different streams. And as a result, there are large volumes of water.
In fact, the police officer we spoke to, even before the body of the doctor was found, told us that that particular portion of the road gets flooded every year. Now the place is being built. What is going to happen when the rains come?
Okay, good question, Malik. I'm going to go around, and instead of asking for final comments like we normally do, I want one question. Yes, his name is Engineer Wise Ametepe. Yes. I want to go around and ask you one question that you think its answer would lead to a solution. Raymond.
Simply, when are we going to implement government's laudable plans to deal with flooding? Okay. The solutions are all in there. Just a roadmap for implementation and sticking to it, we'll all be back home happy.
Novan?
I mean, for me, I think that the simple question that I posed in my article, when is the government going to make funds available to be part of this insurance pool, that is the African risk capacity, so that when disaster comes, we will be able to, we'll get the premiums that we'll use to support and make sure that there are no challenges, or we are not even hit as far as the bottom line with the gas.
Because another part of this thing, just to add, another part is that we would then be able to predict when disasters are about
exactly,
to happen.
Because
there's a software involved that has a predictive capacity.
Exactly. That helps your meteor agency and all those people.
Thank you, Novan. And anyway, your question.
How many more people are going to have to die before the government can do what they can so that this doesn't happen again?
Well, so those are the questions to you. And I would also ask you, the Guinean, when are you going to start speaking up and getting angry enough? Yeah, so that you can also begin demanding from your elected officials. I mean, let's begin to ask those questions of the people we vote for every day as well. It's 28 minutes to the top of the hour here on the Super Morning Show. I'm just going to run through the questions that we've asked. Number one from Raymond is, when are we going to implement the plans we ourselves have drawn up to bring a solution to flooding? Number two from Novan is that, when are we going to start paying the premiums to the ARCA so that, first of all, we'll know when disasters are about to strike and we'll have the funds, we can access the funds to provide relief to persons who are affected and rebuild their lives? And Enimwa's chilling question, how many more lives are we going to lose before we care enough? We're going to put a pin in it on this point, and we're going to continue asking our questions, this time of the Education Ministry, because something is about to happen that could change the face of higher education in this country. It's called the Public Universities Bill. We'll take you through the details of what the bill is going to change, and then we'll talk about how that change can affect academic work when we come back. Stay with us. This is the Super Morning Show.
I want you to first think big, not small. Think of how great we can be when we work together. Together, we can ensure that our hard work will provide a better future. Together, we can provide a foundation for you and your business to succeed.